Okay. We have done a lot of wrapping, so I'm just gonna, you're gonna like rapid fire, get this down, okay? So, when the equation looks like this, graphing it can be a really simple thing. Can anybody tell me the first very simple thing that you can do? Lily? JC?
X can be 0.
X can be 0. It just can't be any easier than plugging 0 in for x, right? What happens when I plug in 0 for x?
Times
0. So we're going to multiply 2 fifths times 0, and that is?
0.
We're going to subtract 2 from 0 and get?
-2.
2. Okay? You're going to do this many times today, so you may want to get involved. All right? Now, this next thing, like that 0, is like the same every single time. Carter, but the next thing is what? What would you do next? Laugh about an orange, maybe?
Yeah.
Does that help?
No.
No, okay. Tiana?
You could do the reciprocal, which would make it 1, and then -2.
Well, that's pretty clever. You can put 5 halves in there, and then we'll get 2 fifths times 5 halves is 1, 1 minus 2 is -1. Mm-hmm. I like that. The only thing about that is that I had to plug in a fraction for x, and now when I go to graph this point, I'll have to graph a fraction for x that's going to work perfectly fine, right? 5 halves is going to be, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 halves. I just counted halves, I counted 5 of them, and -1. But can I do the same kind of a thing where I wind up getting a non-fraction here, but I plug instead of a fraction a whole number? Two fifths is not a whole number.
I got it.
You got a number?
5.
You plug in the whole number 5. Let's watch this happen. 2 fifths times 5/1 -2. Okay. If we just carry this out like kind of the long way. If we multiply fractions, how do we multiply fractions? We talked about this last class.
Straight across.
Not cross multiply. Don't need a common denominator. 2 times 5 is 10. 5 times 1 is 5. And look at that, 10 divided by 5.
It's 2.
It's 2. Are we surprised that this number is divisible by 5?
No.
No, because we made it divisible by 5. We put a number there that put a factor of 5 into the numerator. And 2 minus 2 is 0, so we have a third point now. And those 3 points, including that one that Tiana suggested with the reciprocal, they all seem to be making what kind of shape?
A line.
A straight line, as opposed to a curve, right? So making a straight line. Zach and Lane, how's it going?
Good.
You learning something?
Yep, yes.
By not taking notes, looking at each other, and not paying attention? Seems like not a good strategy. Grab this. It's not very straight, but it's pretty straight. Okay. So let's recap. What was the first thing we did? It was like the easiest thing we could possibly do. Yes? From 0 for x, so we multiply by 0, we get 0, -2, and just -2 is all that's left. And then, it's a little harder to encapsulate, I guess. What did we do that after that? What was the pretty easy thing we did after plugging 0 in for x?
The reciprocal?
No.
Did that, but even easier than the reciprocal was, because you got to put in a whole number and get out a whole number, Tiana?
We put it on the line. We put it on the graph.
Okay, we graph the point 0, -2. Graph that. Okay. Then where did we plug it for x? After the reciprocal. Robert?
5.
We plugged in 5. And when we plugged in 5/1, we made sure that this fraction could be simplified to a whole number because we made this number divisible by the denominator of 5. So we plugged in 5. 2 times 5 is 10. 10 divided by 5 is 2. This again. When your equation looks like this, and by this I mean y equals number times x plus number or minus number, when it looks like that, the easiest thing you can do is start by doing what?
Zero.
Zero over x. again, 0 for x. 5 halves times 0 is what?
0.
Plus 1 is?
1.
Okay. 5 halves times 0 plus 1. That is. So this time, though, what are we going to plug in for x after that, Zach?
Whatever you want to put in.
You could. Anything you want to plug in for x, you could plug in for x, but there is a number that will, when we plug it in for x, I'll just write this right here. When we plug this number in for x, and we multiply these together, when this number here will be, we can simplify it down to a whole number, like whole numbers, because they're easy to work with, to graph.
1.
If we plug in 1, what are we going to wind up? When we multiply 5 halves times 1 over 1, what are we going to get?
The same thing.
The same thing, 5 halves. Does 5 halves simplify to a whole number? We would like it to simplify to a whole number. So now that's perfectly legitimate. It gives us a point, but the point, it has a fraction. So it's kind of a hassle. What do you think now, Zach? What number can I plug in here? So if I multiply 5 times this number, right, and 2 times this number, I'll get something
2 over 5.
Basically divisible by 2. 2 over 5, that will make a whole number, but again, remember I'm saying I want to plug in a whole number. Essentially, I want to plug in a number over 1. So what number can I put there? So when I multiply this guy by that guy, I will get a number here that's divisible by 2.
2.
Let's see. Plus 5 times 2?
10.
Is 10 divisible by 2?
Yeah.
Not a big surprise, because we put a factor of 2 into that number. Right? We put a factor of 2 in there. And 10 divided by 2 is 5 plus 1, 6. So we plugged in 2, we got 6. All right, so 0 gave us a 1, 2 gave us 6. There we go. Lane?
You can do 4.
Absolutely, you can plug in 4. 5 halves times 4 over 1 plus 1. This will be divisible by 2, right? Because 4 is divisible by 2, making sure the numerator is divisible by 2. 5 times 4 is 20 over 2 is 10. Hold on just a second. 20 over 2 plus 1. 20 divided by 2 is 10 plus 1. There's an 11, 4 comma 11. And we can plot that. 4 comma 11 just barely fits, right? And hey, look at that. Like the point that Lane suggested by plugging in a 4 for x, right in line for those other points, right on the same straight line. Do we need any more points?
No, we could, but...
We could, but we don't really need to find any specific points. But really, to draw this line, I actually need to plot how many points? Technically?
1.
2.
0. Much higher.
5. 4. 10.
6.
10.
More.
6. 20.
80. 4.
100.
Infinite.
Right? So,
infinite is not a number, it's just an everlasting amount.
When I do this, I plot an infinite number of points. Okay, of course, this is technical, theoretical in a way, but technically, I could zoom in forever and look at any two points and find points between those points and points in between any two points that I choose. Okay, so I'm really plotting an infinite number of points. Okay. And any point that you could find by plugging in an x, at least an x that's between, like, say, negative 5 and positive 4, it's all on this line right here. All of those points are there. I plot them all by plotting that, by drawing that line. Okay, so on this next screen, 4 times, we're going to do the same thing. We're going to start with the first thing. What was the first thing we did on both of these graphs?
Multiplied by
0. Put a 0 in for x, multiplied by 0 in the output. Okay, so I want you to do that for all 4 of these. Just the 0 part. Just plug in the 0, plug in the 0, plug in the 0, plug in the 0. Okay? 4. I wanted you to plug in 0 for every one of these. So if I plug in 0 for x, what's 3/4 times 0?
0.
0 minus 5?
Negative 5.
So I plug in a 0 for x, right? 0 for x. We're not over here to the right.
You're
the positive x's. We're not over here in the negative
zero.
X's. We're on the y-axis here. We're down 5.
I did this wrong, but that's
alright. Here we go. Okay, so we come over here. We plug in 0 for x. What's 6 sevenths times 0? 6 sevenths times 0
Zero.
Zero. Zero minus one?
Zero.
Negative one.
No,
one.
Right there. Okay, we just found a couple of points. For this one, we found the point 0, negative 5. There it is. This one, we found 0, negative 1. There we go. These points are saying, if x is 0, y will be negative 5. We found that to be true. If x is 0 here, y will be negative 1.
Yes, it will.
If x is 0 here, what will y be?
Negative.
No,
no,
positive
3. 3. 0 times 5, 8.
Close.
Anything times 0 will be 0, and 0 plus 3 will be 3. So there's 0, 3. Ah. It's got an error. We'll plug in 0,
nine.
And we'll get 9.
92.
Okay. You noticing a pattern?
Yes.
Yeah.
That you just got a soul.
It's so easy.
Every time I plug in 0 for x, I just get this thing here, because this term is gone. It's multiplied by 0. And the only thing left is subtract this number or add this number or whatever it is. It's being added or subtracted to 0. So it just is this number. Mm. Now, that's the easiest part, because that's universal. For every equation, you can just plug in 0 for x. And now we're going to have to decide what the best x after that is. Who can tell me for this one what the easiest x to plug in would be? Heard from Tiana a lot today. You say?
12.
12 would work nicely. 12 is a little bigger than it has to be. We can plug in a smaller number that
six.
Works well.
No.
4 and 6.
Yeah,
4 and 6.
4.
New
4 and 6?
I need 4.
4.
So 4, I'm asking the x value of 4, and you're saying you get 6, is that right?
No.
No, you don't get
2.
You get 2. Let's see, let's write out this work. 3/4 times 4 over 1 minus 5. Unless you are just killing this graphing stuff, you should probably be paying attention and writing down everything I'm writing down. 3 times 4, straight across, right? 3 times 4 is 12. 4 times 1 is 4. Minus 5. 12 divided by 4 is 3, minus 5, negative 2.
Yep.
Negative 2. Let me erase all this stuff.
No.
Okay. 4, negative 2. You might have had it all down if you were talking while I was doing it in the first place. Okay. There we go. 2 points. We have a graph. Okay. Together, we're going to decide on the simplest choice for x, this one, and then I'm going to let all of you individually do these last two. So what would be the easiest value to plug in for x in this equation?
Seven.
Why 7?
Because that's the denominator.
It's the denominator. And if I plug in a number that is a multiple of the denominator, then all this work, for instance, we'll make it so that this fraction that I get when I multiply these two together
is divisible by
7. Well, then, yeah, the numerator is divisible by the denominator, and I'll just get a whole number. 6 times 7 is 42 over 7 minus 1. 2 divided by 7, 6 times 1, you get 5. So you plugged in 7, did all this work, and this is nice. The denominator canceled the numerator, and we get a whole number. 6 minus 1 is 5. So 7. Here, 7, 5. Go. Line down there. All right, so as Caden says, we plug in 7 here because 7 is in the denominator of the fraction that's in the equation. So let's use that same strategy for these last two. Individually work on that for another. So for this one, what would we plug in for x?
8.
Agenda's down. 8. What's 5 8 times 8?
40 over 8.
40 over 8, which simplifies to
5.
5. 5 plus 3.
8. 8. 8. 8.
Ooh, I got it.
8. 8.
Perfect square.
Gosh.
Wow.
Yeah, like It would make a square if we drew lines there. There you go. There's our second point. We'll draw a line in a minute. How about this last one? This one, I'm going to write this board down. I saw some mistakes there. What number would you plug in for x?
3.
Okay, let's see the work here. Negative 4 thirds. Remember to say negative 4 thirds times 3 over 1 plus 9. Right? So we get negative times positive. That's a negative 12 over 3 plus 9. What's negative 12 divided by 3?
Negative
4 plus 9, which is?
It's
5.
Yeah, 12.
I don't think you did.
You are not rich.
Okay, so that's you put in a 3, you got out of 5. You got to remember that's a negative right there. Let's make some room for this other point. 3, 5. Now listen to this. I was going around and I pointed that out to somebody that it was negative. Right, they had done all this work. They said negative. Well, they had really said, they said 4 thirds times 3 over 1 plus 9 is 12 over 3 plus 9 is 4 plus 9 is 13. They said, you forgot this is a negative.
Yeah.
Right? So this person, instead of fixing it and saying, oh, if I plug in 3, I get 5, they just said, well, I'll just make this a negative 3. Because negative 4 thirds times negative 3 will come out to be a positive 12 over 3, negative times negative, positive 4. Okay, so then they made it so that 13 does come out of that function, but they just have to plug in a negative 3 and get 13. Okay, so that point is also valid. So that's negative 3, there's 11, 12, 13. And what do you know, it's right on that same straight line. Yeah, it's going down instead of going up. It's a good observation. As opposed to all three of these where they're going from left to right, bottom to top, this last one is going down as you look to the right. Right? So we plug in 0 for x, and then what do we plug in for x?
The denominator.
Whatever the denominator is. Or anything that is divisible by the denominator, as Lane pointed out earlier when he said, on this other one, I think it was just this one right here, can we plug in 4? Yeah, we can plug in 4, because that gives us also a number that's divisible by 4, right? 20 divided by, sorry, a number that's divisible by 2. We plug in 4, 20, divisible by 2, we get 10 plus 1, right? So for x, we can plug in anything that's divisible by the denominator, so that we make a fraction that simplifies down to a whole number instead of a fraction. Very good observations there. Now, last thing that I want to work on, something we've done before, but I want it to be fresh in your minds for tomorrow. Okay? So let's just quickly talk about. So we're here to get better. So, you think of a story that goes along with this equation, y equals 2x plus 4. Feel free to just raise your hand if you feel like you've got one that's ready to go. No, I'm not looking at how to solve. I'm looking for a story like this person went to this place, or they did this at this rate.
Pick me, bruh.
Bruh.
Chicken strips in your pocket.
Or just get that
chicken.
Why didn't he just get
this
stuff?
All right, did you come up with a story?
Almost done.
Almost done.
I have no word.
A what?
Seed story.
A seed story? Yeah, that was a great story. Can you apply that same idea to this one?
Probably not, but I'll try.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, I forgot it.
You have your notes from last time. Did you write it down from last time? Might be in there. Yeah.
Okay, JD buys clothes from online. It's $2 for every article of clothing plus $4 shipping cost.
Nice, that's perfect. So $2 per article of clothing, $2 for a pants, great price of pants, $2 for a shirt, $2 for whatever, right? Plus the $4 where four is, it's just four. It's one time that you pay $4. It's not $4 every article of clothing, it's not $4 per anything, okay? It's just a flat $4 for shipping. This story works great. It gives us this guy right here, right, where you read per, $2 per article. That's what we call a rate of change. As the number of articles changes, the amount of money changes. So, you know, how much would it cost to buy 10 articles of clothing, if this is the case?
$24.
Two times, right? $2 per article times 10 articles of clothing plus $4 for shipping. Right? Article canceled with article. Two times 10, $20 plus four, $24. Silly situation, but if I were to buy zero articles of clothing from this company, how much would it cost me?
$4.
Actually, $4. It would ship me an empty box. They charge me $4 for it.
For not buying it?
They didn't actually do that.
They wouldn't actually do that, but I mean, what could we do?
It was for signing up.
Yeah.
You didn't buy anything? $4?
So, now, if I buy... If I buy one article of clothing, how many more dollars do I have to pay on top of the $4?
Two.
Two more dollars. One article of clothing, right? One article of clothing, two more dollars. Another article of clothing, two more dollars. One more article of clothing, we're up to three now, two more dollars. We see that rate of change here on the line. Every time you move over one, you move up two. Okay?
Can I do my problem
now? We're going to do one per equation. I'm going to bring this one up. You want to write one for that one?
Yeah, I'll just do the same problem, but worded differently.
Okay.
Okay. Y is how many miles to Utah?
From here.
Right here. Yeah. Okay, and then 5 is how fast you're going.
5 what?
5 miles per hour, and X is how many hours it takes.
And X is hours.
Yep, and then -2 is a food break.
4 minus 2 is because going 2 miles over 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Well, see,
it's
5 miles per hour times, let's say, 3 hours. What's that going to be?
This is 15.
15 what?
Miles.
Miles, right? Miles. So -2, that 2 should be in, if I'm going to subtract it from 15, should be in miles. How does 2 miles get subtracted?
You go back 2 miles because you forgot something.
Okay,
yeah.
Go back 2 miles because you forgot something.
Yeah.
Maybe you went back 2 miles.
You forgot your baby.
Wanted to go get
baby. Forgot your baby.
Yeah.
You
don't know
how
old
the parents. You don't know how old the parents are. Okay. So let's say we started out. And then, oh no, we forgot we have to go back and get our baby, right? So it
is that the last
we start out at -2. Oh, we lost those 2 miles because we had to go back. And then every mile, every hour that goes by, we go 5 miles, which is terribly slow. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So in 1 hour, we are 5 miles back down the road. And we're 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 more miles down the road. Another hour.
It could be 5 hours per mile.
Oh,
guys,
really
that
works.
Is really slow. 5 miles per hour.
Okay, like last one. Last one. Write a story for this equation.
Oh.
Okay, so you dig a hole 6 inches, you dig a hole at 6 inches, okay? And then you have a plant and it grows a certain amount of inches, X inches, and you dig 6 more inches every month, I guess. We'll just go with that. Six inches
per month.
Per month, yeah. And then one day, just out of the random amount of months, you decide to put 96 inches back into the hole.
Okay.
That's a long time.
Put 96 inches worth of dirt back in. Okay, so now we can see how has Deanna incorporated the negative that's in front of the six?
With the hole she dug to put the seed in.
No, I didn't put a seed in.
She just continued digging this hole.
She's digging a hole.
Okay, so what's negative about that?
It's underground.
Yeah, it's under the ground. Going down into the ground.
And then she put 96 inches of gravel.
Okay.
Dirt.
Maybe that's
it.
And it
more
dirt
in.
Maybe, okay, so she dug down, and when she got to the point where it's 96 feet deep, she put in 96 feet of gravel.
So put back.
Maybe that's it. Okay, that makes sense. Okay. How about this? Let's see. The deposit. Right, I put in $96 into an account. Maybe at a gym or something like that. Put in $96, and then they deduct $6 per month, which is really good price. $6 per month, they deduct $6 every month, and well, that could account for this equation. X could be the number of months, right? So anything where there's some positive, like a starting point almost, 96, starting at a positive 96 and going down, we are losing money, we're losing dirt, we're losing a certain amount of something every month or every hour, every minute, okay? What I want you to see about this, is that this guy right here, in each of these, whether it be $2 per article, 5 miles per hour, $6 per month, right? That's what we call a rate of change. Rate of change. And this is what we call this a starting point. A starting value, an initial value, something like that. So when we see an equation like that, we can think of these two numbers in that way. This is like a rate, like miles per hour or dollars per day or anything like that. And this is just a starting amount. The starting amount for shipping. You start out with $4 just because they're shipping it to you. We started out at -2 miles because we forgot our baby. We started out at $96 because we just put $96 in the account to start with, right? A starting amount. Right. This right here is your homework, so that nobody comes back and says, "Did we have homework? We had homework?
What?
The homework?
That's not our homework.
That's
not
our homework.
Right here.
So
this is
4.1. Except for tonight?
Yeah, sorry, I pointed the wrong one. It's this one right here. Eighth grade math at the top. That's your homework.
This is a cadence.